Oyasumi Punpun is dark, depressive, violent, scary, enigmatic, confusing, and overall, just a sad story. It features a boy, Onodera Punpun, as he travels from adolescence to adulthood. And if you've ever read a story by Inyu Asano, the mangaka for Goodnight Punpun, then you know that this is going to be one hell of a trip. And I will warn you ahead of time that if you're in a bad place in your life, if you feel depressed or anxious, then this may not be the best video to watch right now. But if you are up for the challenge, if you feel like you can handle the dread, the depression, and the anxiety that is Oyasumi Punpun, then I've just got two words for you. Good vibrations. Punpun is depressed going to school, knowing that Mio is moving away. He first encountered the girl when she was feeding gravel to Yoshikawa. Despite this egregious behavior, Punpun decided he liked Mio. A new girl is thusly introduced to the class. My name is Aiko Tanaka. It was love at first sight. The students are then tasked with writing an essay about their dreams. Punpun walks home with Aiko after school. After she says goodbye, Punpun wonders what kind of adult he'll be. At home, Punpun's dad loses it when there's no beer in the fridge, verbally and physically abusing the mother. Punpun then goes to his room and chants, dear God, tinkle tinkle hoy.
What do you ask of God, Punpun?
After somewhat answering Punpun's questions, Punpun's dad enters the room with a telescope. From that moment, Punpun decided that he wanted to study outer space. Perhaps this would make Aiko fall in love with him. The next morning, Punpun's mother is knocked out on the floor. The father claims it was a robber. Uncle Yuichi, Punpun's mother's brother, decides to care for the boy as she recovers in the hospital. At school, Punpun's teacher freaks out a bit, thinking he didn't do his homework. But it turns out he did. He steps to the front of the class. Unfortunately, he gets nervous and says he wants to be a normal salaryman. Punpun then hides in the gym storeroom. The other kids talk about how Punpun's dad is in jail for assault, as Aiko reads Punpun's essay. Aiko urges Punpun to believe in himself, as she takes his hand and guides him to the school gym. Punpun tells Aiko that he loves her, and she gives him a quick kiss. For the rest of the day, Punpun feels a profound nervousness, but at the same time, feels as though he's fated to be with Aiko. Punpun then visits his mother in the hospital with his uncle. Punpun thinks about how he doesn't really like his mother, though. He asks Yuichi when his dad is coming home. We also find out that his uncle taught him the tinkle tinkle spell to call upon God. Later on, as Punpun hangs out with the PMSA, i.e. the Porno Meg Search Alliance, they gawk at a nudie meg together until some girls catch them, one of which being Aiko. They lie about what they're doing, and Aiko hopes that Punpun isn't lying to her. At home, Punpun thinks of Aiko and the nudie meg in his bed, ejaculating in the process. A piece of my brain just shot out of my wiener! Thinks Punpun. Yuichi then gives Punpun a medical book to ease his woes about the incident, but it just freaks him out further. Punpun freaks out when he discovers a new star, thinking it will make Aiko like him. In gym class, Punpun passes out when he thinks about how when a boy puts his thing inside of a girl. While resting in the nurse's office, Aiko lays down next to him. She admits that she loves him, which utterly blows Punpun's mind. Aiko tells Punpun that if he thinks of anything else but her happiness, he'll quote-unquote get it. After hearing this, Punpun is utterly terrified. Harumin gets dumped by his girlfriend, so they head over to Punpun's to watch a porno. After watching a little bit, a man appears on the screen, claiming he just killed his entire family. The man hid the bodies, along with some money, at an unused miso factory. The video cuts back to the porno as the boys think they've been pranked. After Yuichi returns home, Punpun notices the porno tape in the open. He attempts to tiptoe to it, but Yuichi thinks he's performing some kind of a dance and joins in. Later on, a woman arrives at Punpun's house, selling space Cosmo water. Yet the woman's false claims just irritates Yuichi. Punpun then calls upon God.
Howdy ho, Punpun! What's the word?
God tells him to ask his uncle where the apple grater is. Meanwhile, Yuichi's rage hits a peak as he insults the woman's god. The woman persists on, causing Yuichi to yell,
THERE IS NO GOD!
Punpun walks in, seeing Aiko next to the strange woman. Aiko runs away as Punpun chases after her. After getting hit by a bicyclist, Aiko is devastated that Punpun found out about her crazy mother.
I want to go somewhere far away, so far that nobody knows where I am, says Aiko.
Punpun blurts out that he's going to win the Nobel Prize so that they can live together, but she says he's retarded. Punpun, unsure what to do, clings onto Aiko. She says they'll go away together, and that if he breaks his promise, she'll kill him. Punpun thusly promises to go to Kagoshima with her after the first semester. Yuichi informs Punpun of the exorbitant cost of plane tickets, killing his idea of going to Kagoshima.
Shimizu runs an errand for his mother and runs into the god of poop. The god of poop says he can do anything, as Seki punches him for being an idiot. Punpun and his friends decide to go to the miso factory, hoping they can find the money mentioned in the video. Aiko decides to tag along, but the other boys are not pleased. Seki says when the factory went under, so did his dad's shop. The group peers into the creepy factory, with Punpun noting that he has to take a pee. A teenage girl reveals herself, saying she comes here for privacy. The blood on her head is from her violent father. She warns him that the owner committed suicide by fire, and to watch out for his ghost. Harumin then reveals that he's moving away at the end of the semester. Seki has a flashback when he talked to the president of the factory as a child. Seki then gets angry, since the factory going down set his family's business underwater as well, so he decides to set it on fire, but Harumin stomps on the flame. They all head to the roof, but are freaked out when Shimizu spots a shadowy figure. A beam knocks out Aiko as the other boys get lost in the factory. The boys finally find the exit, with Shimizu going back for Punpun and Aiko. The man approaches Punpun, to which he thinks, "I have to take a ferocious pee!" The factory then goes up in flames. The shadowy figure speaks to Punpun as he pisses through his clothes. Punpun then reminisces about a time in his life in which his mother wished that she never had him. We then see a time in which Yuichi picked him up after he was chasing a shooting star, and thusly taught him the spell to summon God. God then talks about loneliness, and people never truly understanding one another. Punpun then remembers when he moved into his house with his parents. Aiko wakes up an unconscious Punpun on the roof. An exorcist says there's evil spirits in the building. The group then leaves the building, yet Punpun feels he'll be unable to fulfill his promise he made to Aiko. A news report details the murders at the miso factory. Punpun's mom is getting home tomorrow, yet she states that she hates kids. Punpun starts stressing out. Pretty soon, Aiko is gonna kill me! Harumin says his farewells to the class. At home, Punpun stresses out about his situation with Aiko. Yuichi finds out that his sister fell down the emergency stairs at the hospital. In a taxi, Yuichi states that this escapist behavior is typical of his sister. Punpun contemplates the notion that Aiko chickened out of her commitment to go to Kagoshima, but then we see her crying on the side of the road. Yuichi agrees to live with his sister from now on, as Punpun sulks on the couch. Punpun and his mom return home with Yuichi. God takes pleasure in Punpun's emotional pain. Yuichi thinks about getting a job as summer vacation is already over. Aiko ignores Punpun at school, as he wishes that she just kill him. After school, Punpun apologizes to Aiko, but she continues walking. Punpun's dad then arrives, wondering why he's crying. He determines that Punpun was dumped by the girl that walked away. His dad says he can't come around the house anymore. He'll thusly be heading to America to join NASA. The father says he loves his son, and henceforth departs. Upon returning home, Punpun's surname has changed from Punyama to Onodera. Punpun thusly decided he wanted to be an adult, and he wouldn't be afraid of anything anymore. God mocks him, however, saying he's still a kid. Punpun walks through the empty school, wishing he could evaporate away. Perhaps he could fly away like a bird. The mom scolds Punpun as he falls asleep during dinner. Good night, Punpun. 2 years later, and Yuichi and the lawyer are still good friends. A woman spills coffee on Yuichi as he feels like he knows her. Punpun joins the badminton club. Punpun then sees Aiko, who hasn't spoken to him in 2 years. He sees her holding hands with Yaguchi, which sends him into a downward spiral. Seki struggles in school, and has a talk with his guidance counselor. Shimizu gives some kids some money, so Seki beats them up and demands they return it. The female bully shows Seki a fire, which triggers the bad memories from 2 years ago. After the fight, Seki tells Shimizu that he'll protect him if he remains by his side. Punpun tries to convince himself that if Aiko's happy, then it's all good. But it wasn't all good. In the bath, Punpun wonders if Aiko has kissed or even had sex with Yaguchi. Punpun's dad writes him a letter, speaking highly of himself, though he's only a night guard at a hydro plant. Kids in class gossip about Aiko, speculating that she's a prostitute. Punpun leaves school in a sour mood, saying to himself that Aiko is not a bad girl. Blackness fills Punpun's heart, wishing that he could see her again. Yaguchi asks Punpun why he skipped badminton practice, as God tells Punpun to kill him. The two walk home together. After Yaguchi talks about his badminton skills, he asks Punpun if he likes anyone. The two depart, and Punpun notes that he likes Yaguchi as a friend, but he still wants Aiko. Punpun is thusly confused. God recommends that he kills others to prevent others from hurting him. Yaguchi suffers an injury at badminton practice. In class, Komatsu says that equality and peace do not exist, but Punpun wonders why everyone can't be happy. Afterwards, Punpun spots Aiko crying. She walks past Punpun without uttering a word. Punpun then thinks that Yuguchi is a terrible person for making Aiko cry, but then he wonders if Aiko still hates him. Yuguchi tells Punpun that his doctor won't let him play, and that Aiko won't let him touch her hand. When Yuguchi mentioned Punpun's name to Aiko, she started crying. Punpun admits that he likes Aiko. Yuguchi says that if he loses in the tournament, Punpun has to confess his feelings to her, but if he wins, he'll keep Aiko forever. At the coffee shop, the waitress apologizes to Yuichi for spilling coffee on him. As it turns out, the waitress is the same girl who took care of his sister when she was in the hospital. She then leaves a note asking for a date. Yuichi frees up some time to see Midori. Yuichi and Midori thusly go to karaoke, yet Yuichi spends most of his time analyzing Midori's intentions. Though he likes Midori, he can't forget about his past, quote-unquote, regrets. Yuichi leaves suddenly, with Midori wondering what's going on. Later on, Yuichi returns to the coffee shop to talk to Midori. She tells him about her dreams and about opening her own cafe. As it turns out, another man is pursuing her, but she feels there's someone else in her life that she likes more. Yuichi says he's scum and begins to push her away by diminishing himself. Midori then gives Yuichi an option to pay 1 million yen for a single cup of coffee or tell her about his past. Yuichi's story begins 5 years ago. He was a ceramics teacher for middle-aged women. One student, Mrs. Yagi, took a liking to him and brought her beautiful 16-year-old daughter to class. Yuichi noted that they were reading the same book. He also took note of her curves. The girl jokes that she's tied down by her mother. Yuichi cannot control himself any longer, and he gets an erection while staring at her. The girl then performs the Dear God, Tinkle Tinkle Hoi spell. The girl then says she'll go back to school if Yuichi goes on a date with her, and he says yes. We then see him pick up Punpun and teach him the God spell. Later on, the girl arrives to meet Yuichi in the empty classroom. The two talk about their life and happiness, until the girl reveals that she had an abortion a half a year ago, and that her mom really ties her up for protective reasons. If she returns home now, she might be dead. Yuichi thusly takes the girl to his apartment due to the rain. When the power goes out, she kisses and humps him. Yuichi urges her to stop, but she doesn't want to. She wants to run away and start a life with him. But just then, Yuichi's girlfriend walks in. The girlfriend starts stripping as the 16-year-old girl hides in the closet. The girlfriend then brings up marriage and how they've been dating for 5 years. Although Yuichi is hesitant, he says he loves her and they have crazy sex. Afterwards, he thinks he dreamed up the situation with the 16-year-old girl, only to find her in the closet the next morning. Yuichi lets the girl out as his girlfriend sleeps. After 2 weeks, Yuichi returns to school, where Mrs. Yagi asks him out for lunch. Yuichi asks about her daughter, and the mother just babbles on. Just then, Washio bashes her head with a hammer. Yuichi is told to go and call the police. He exits the store and runs into the 16-year-old. Is she dead? My mother? It turns out that the girl gave Washio a blowjob to kill his mother, as Yuichi realizes the terrible side of humanity. The girl then disappears before his eyes, without him even knowing her name. Yuichi henceforth quit his job and left the girlfriend. I despise myself. Midori says she likes him and wants to head toward the pottery class. Punpun worries about the badminton tournament, hoping that Yuguchi will be forced to forfeit. Yuichi finds out that Mrs. Yagi didn't suffer major injuries and didn't file a lawsuit due to her daughter's wishes. The daughter is now studying arts in Kyoto. Yuichi leaves with Midori as it looks like everything turned out well. Yuichi thanks her as the two depart. Afterward, Yuichi feels tormented by the past. He drops his groceries and waits on train tracks as a train is heading his way. The only things left are a meaningless life and a fear of the inevitable empty future. We see Yuichi's god as he cries on the tracks. Midori chucks his groceries at him. You idiot! The train passes by with Yuichi hanging onto Midori's leg. I just can't do it! I can't kill myself! Midori urges Yuichi to never leave her. He says if he does anything unforgivable, to kill him. Miss Midori, I like you. Yuguchi's in the finals, but his injured foot might be a problem. Punpun then notices Aiko. Punpun becomes frustrated when Aiko doesn't avert her gaze. Punpun then thinks about scraping her eyeballs out or giving her a tender kiss. Surprisingly, Yuguchi is winning the match. Aiko talks about love, saying that she's all alone as she holds Punpun's hand. Aiko is willing to throw everything away for love, whereas Punpun is not. She has a reoccurring dream where she waits for someone by the waterfront. She then sees her birth mother, runs for her, but then realizes it was her own reflection in the water. Aiko would rather die than be without the person that she loves. Aiko asks Yaguchi to run away with her. He laughed it off though. Punpun is internally torn about what he should do. God warns him if he doesn't stop the nice guy act, he'll end up killing himself or committing a crime. Punpun squeezes Aiko's hand as Yaguchi collapses to the ground. Yaguchi claims that he lost the match to Punpun as he begins to sob. Punpun feels the existence of another self in his head, a despicable version that Aiko could see. Punpun then apologizes for not going to Kagoshima 2 years ago. Then, should we go now? To Kagoshima? Says Aiko. Punpun tells her that Yaguchi needs her more, and he thusly leaves. Punpun falls in the snow and begins crying. Goodbye, Aiko. Yuichi introduces Midori as his new girlfriend. Punpun runs away. He has a dream where he falls deeper and deeper into darkness. God says that everyone has two choices in life. To do or not to do. That's it. Punpun awakes, feeling as though his life is not long. Punpun sulks when at school. Seki tells his counselor that he's not going to high school, as he runs into Punpun afterward. Punpun tells the counselor he wants to save the world, and thusly joins the Go board game club. Yuichi and Midori take Punpun to the amusement park. Midori's owner is talking about taking care of his mother, giving the girl the chance to run the shop for herself and realize her dream. Yuichi says that when they both settle down with their jobs, they'll get married. Midori's been with the Onoderos for a month now, and Punpun's mom says they're like a family. Punpun sulks in his room, wondering what a child who grew up in a house with domestic violence should do. How the hell would I know? God says that Punpun was the one who gave him the label of God. Punpun then wonders who he really is. Despite his emotional turmoil, Punpun feels that good times must be ahead of him. 2 years later, and Punpun's mom sells the house. The mother and Midori talk about Punpun's entrance exams, and the fact that Yuichi's been gone for a week. We then see a weeping Yuichi on the railroad tracks once again. Punpun graduates middle school, thinking about how Seki knocked up a girl and skipped school for a month. But despite this, one issue was pressing on Punpun's mind. Sex. Or, to phrase it in a better way, to do the old in and out.
Come with uncle and hear all proper. Hear angel trumpets and devil trombones.
I want to do the old in and out. Punpun sees Midori in a somber mood. At the market, Yuichi buys a knife. Punpun walks past Aiko after he graduates. Yet he doesn't utter a word. With Yuichi gone, Midori tells Punpun that she's moving back with her parents. Yuichi leaves the knife on the ground and tells the lawyer to do whatever he likes to him. Midori and Punpun walk home. Punpun reassures him by saying Yuichi will probably return soon. In a taxi, Yuichi tells the driver he committed adultery, and he's now being sued for 2 million yen. Punpun's mom offered to sell the house to pay off the debt. Yugami, the lawyer friend, liked Midori first, so Yuichi kept the relationship hidden from him for 2 years. Hence the reason he left the knife on the ground and gave him the option to kill him. Midori lies down, asking Punpun to stay with her. The driver says he was a former Yakuza member, and he was saved by his wife. She passed away 1 month ago, and he never had the opportunity of saying thank you. But Yaguchi has time left. Punpun then recalls past memories inside the house as they get ready to leave it for the last time. The three take a picture in front of the house as a final farewell. Midori and Punpun then return to the coffee shop. Midori cries over Yuichi as she begins to clutch onto Punpun. Midori tells Punpun about the affair that Yuichi had and her willingness to forgive him nevertheless. She says that when you lose what's most precious to you, you won't be able to recognize yourself. She reaches into Punpun's boxers, but he immediately pulls back. She then hints at sex, saying just a little while, and she proceeds to mount the teenage boy. In the midst of intercourse, Punpun thinks of Aiko. Afterwards, Midori tells Punpun to come again to visit her, but he leaves the shop without an utterance. Punpun returns to his apartment, wondering what he's doing in a place like this. Perhaps he should be in the afterworld. Nevertheless, he decides to push on. Punpun's mom then sleeps with a married man that won't leave his wife, so she desperately wishes the world would just disappear. Seki wonders about morality in the park and why everyone can't be happy. Shimizu shows up and Seki tells him they're on the verge of losing their house. A man then offers the two a job for cash. Seki then receives a phone call about another job offer and tells Shimizu to meet him in the park afterwards. A lady tells Seki she wants something awful to happen to a man who was supposed to marry her 1 year ago. She'll therefore pay as much as she can to make sure that he ends up dead. Seki finds his target, wondering if righteous people exist in this world. Seki observes passerbys, equating them with puppets, hollow beings as it were. On the train platform, Seki looks to push the man in front of the coming train. Shimizu is taken to an apartment with a dead, decomposing body inside. He's gonna have to clean it up. Unfortunately, he wets himself in the process and refuses the work. Seki continues following the man. He walks away, however, when he finds out his wife is pregnant and his father is in the hospital. Shimizu thinks that God is fake, as a man named Pegasus arrives. He declares that the Earth will end in 5 years and looks for Shimizu to join the cause. Seki apologizes to his client and she expresses relief. Seki tells her to think of her own happiness rather than someone else's misfortune, but she furiously walks off. Shimizu meets with Seki in the park as they call it a day. Punpun goes to karaoke with his class, but he leaves to sit in the lobby. Kani approaches Punpun, asking if he wants to leave with her. The two walk on the street making small talk until they hear music in the streets. "Do you want to go somewhere fun with me next weekend?" blurts out Punpun. "Yeah, sure." Upon returning home, Mama says that Grandpa passed away. Punpun and his mom meet with Midori at Grandfather's house. Although Punpun wonders what Midori is doing here, Midori says that after that fateful day, Yuichi returned to her. She then hands Punpun a wedding gift as he thinks of severely hurting her. Punpun leaves with his mother in a sour mood, but she excoriates the boy for his pathetic egotism. Punpun reads another letter from his father. With all the emotional turmoil, Punpun chucks Midori's wedding gift in a fit of rage. "He's coming," says Pegasus. Despite everything, Punpun's upcoming date with Kani has him excited. Punpun can't go home tonight since his mom is having another man over. After intercourse, the mother goes through a range of emotions, asking the man to marry her. Unfortunately, he's already a married man and cannot do this for her. The mother goes into the kitchen, only to return with a knife in her hand. She's become tired, wishing to end her life here and now. She then struggles breathing and is taken to the hospital. The doctor diagnoses her with pneumonia thorax and recommends surgery. Punpun visits his mom in the hospital, but she tells him to concentrate on his studies. She then attempts to reach the bathroom under her own strength, but experiences hallucinations. Mama Punpun then wakes up in a boy's arms. The boy was hit by a car on his bike, hence the cast on his leg. The boy's name is Harumi, and he's 16 years old, just like Punpun. Mama Punpun thinks of her husband and the time she threatened to kill herself and Punpun. Papa Punpun knocked her out with a microwave, and henceforth told Punpun that a robber snuck into the house. Harumi tells Mama Punpun that his girlfriend was on the back of his bike, and is in more serious condition than he is. Mama Punpun urges Harumi to see the girl, but he's worried she'll hate him. She tells him that her own son fills her with disgust, and that her loneliness will never go away. She doesn't have a place she can call home, and the outcome of her surgery seems inconsequential to her. Mama Punpun wakes up from a bad dream and talks to Harumi's girlfriend. Though she's able to leave soon, the scars on her face will remain. They continue talking, and Mama thinks that everyone should just go kill themselves. They exchange words of sympathy towards each other, and Mama feels a little bit happy by this. Punpun puts a condom in his wallet and meets Kani for his date. Mama is going into surgery and asks Midori where Punpun is. Mama talks about love and becoming a good mother as the anesthesia kicks in. Punpun and Kani go on their date as Mama is in the midst of surgery. After lunch, Kani's umbrella gets stolen and Punpun lends her his own. They then meet Kani's sister and her friend at an art exhibit. Punpun feels awkward with Kani, propelling him to think of Aiko. He then thinks of his former friends and how they're nowhere to be found. Punpun wonders why he's hanging out with Kani in the first place, and reasons it's due to his horniness. Saichi asks Punpun to write a comment about her painting of the Milky Way, and Punpun thinks about the star he discovered when he was a child. He then chronicles the experiences of his childhood, which puts him on the verge of tears. Punpun gets a boner as Kani and him sit on a bench, but then she says she's heading home. "Could you stay a little longer?" asks Punpun. Punpun thinks only of dirty thoughts as Kani wonders why he's not in the hospital with his mother. "Whether she's family or not, that doesn't really change the fact that she's a separate person from me," replies Punpun. "Onodera, that's just not right. I thought you were smarter than that. And I thought you were smarter than to impose your subjective standards on my circumstances." Despite the tumult, Punpun asks her to go out with him. Kani calls him selfish and says, "You love yourself most, don't you?" Punpun touches Kani's face, looking to do whatever he pleases with her. Mama wakes up from surgery, thinking of Punpun, as the boy gets slapped in the face by Kani. "Onodera, you're a really lonely person, aren't you?" God tells Punpun to kill himself after the egregious event. Punpun then masturbates in the rain. Mama is getting ready to leave the hospital as she finds out Harumi and his girlfriend are standing next to each other. After they kiss, she returns to her room. She reads a letter that was written by Harumi, thanking her for her kindness and being a good person. In the end, however, she says she doesn't understand anything and she's still all alone. Mama returns home, but immediately gets angry when her son won't acknowledge her. Punpun bombs his exams. He then meets Kani in the hallway. They briefly talk as Punpun feels as though he has no self-confidence still left within him. Mama returns to the doctor to check up on her post-surgery recovery. Though everything is fine, he's concerned about possible cancer. On her way home, she mails a letter to Punpun from Papa, indicating that she's been writing the letters all along. Punpun determines that there is no God. Everything is a product of human emotion, and he vows to never fall in love again. Good night, Punpun. 2 years pass, and Mama recalls her past events. In the midst of these memories, the doctor's suspicions are confirmed, and she has cancer. Mama blamed Punpun for ruining her life, asking him to die with her. She's stimulated awake by Midori and Punpun. She grabs her boy's face and apologizes for her coarseness. To be honest, I really love you, Punpun. After the funeral, Punpun thinks that he still can't love his own mother as his dad looks up at him. Midori hands Punpun a letter that resembles his dad's. Mama apologizes in the letter for pretending to be his father all this time, hoping that she can forgive him. Punpun's father then enters the apartment. He makes small talk as if nothing has changed in the past years. The only thing that is different is Punpun himself. Papa then asks Punpun if he'll live with him in Fukushima.
I want to live alone, replies Punpun. Papa says this is fine and reminds him that he'll always be his dad. Punpun punches the door in rage when he leaves. Punpun and Yuichi go on a walk. Yuichi reminds him that responsibility for your own actions is most important of all. Yuichi knows what happened between him and Midori, but he harbors no resentment. Punpun, where will your grave be? And will your life still be burning there and then? As long as you remain yourself, this world will be yours. Punpun carries on with his normal school life, as everyone and everything is passing by in a blur. Punpun is just fine again today. Pegasus meets with his various recruits. The members take turns introducing themselves and their exploits. The new member, Numata, wants to become an accountant. She believes Pegasus to be a god, yet he denies this. He then plays a song for the pussy princess, i.e. Numata. They need two more members, so that in 2 years, they can go to the moon. Punpun heads to his part-time job, which entails pressing a clicker to see how many people walk through the train station. Punpun feels depressed as he feels like he's looking for someone. Afterwards, he considers killing himself by jumping onto the tracks. He boards on nonetheless, only to see Aiko standing on the other side of the door.
Aiko!
Punpun exits the train, desperately searching for Aiko. Despite his drastic attempts at finding her, it was no use. Aiko was nowhere to be found. Punpun wonders what he's been doing these past few years, as he expresses interest in an apartment for sale. Punpun gets Mama's savings account from Midori and Yuichi, since he wants to make the apartment his own. And it's the same apartment that a man died in a few years ago. Punpun opens the door for the first time.
Ah, Punpun, welcome home,
says an imaginary Aiko in Punpun's head. He listens to the couple next door argue about various things, until they eventually make love. Punpun wonders about the man who died in this apartment. He then vows that if nothing changes in 2 years, when he renews the contract, he'll kill himself. Pegasus looks to recruit a man named Mimura. He then vanishes away. Mimura picks up Punpun after his job, and they get dinner together. Mimura babbles on about various subjects racing through his mind, envying Punpun's carefree demeanor. Later on, Punpun fails to find Aiko. At home, Punpun listens to a message from Midori, telling him not to push himself and to accept help from others. Meanwhile, Pegasus activates Mirage Mode to evade some cops. Punpun goes to his clicker job with Mimura, who talks about many things, including attaining his teacher's license. Punpun sees children frolicking about, propelling him to... nothing at all. Punpun continues searching for Aiko, but she's nowhere to be found. Punpun returns home to find a new cell phone that was sent by Midori. In times like these, he would chant, dear God, tinkle tinkle hoy, and... I'm such an idiot. You reap what you sow. Thank you. Punpun wakes up the next morning as a tetrahedron. Punpun is feeling just fine again today. The apartment manager checks in on Punpun and invites him over for lunch. The manager remarks that Punpun has the same lonely eyes as the previous tenant, and that he should trust others by opening up his heart. Punpun then thinks of the previous women in his life, with his expression remaining unchanged. The manager takes him out for a drink at a bar. Just then, a girl drenched in rain comes in. It turns out to be Sachi from the art exhibit that he went to with Kani. Sachi mentions that Kani was depressed after that day with him. Punpun becomes uncomfortable with the bluntness of the conversation and looks to leave. Sachi grabs his hand, saying she's interested in the story he wrote inside her notebook and wants to buy his talents. Punpun gets drunk after a single sip of alcohol. In a daze, he thinks of how far Aiko is. Punpun, if you ever betray me again, I'll kill you. Punpun wakes up the next morning, finding Sachi sleeping on the floor. Punpun transfixes on Sachi's exposed underwear, thinking of all sorts of dirty thoughts. Sachi wakes up, and Punpun pretends to be asleep. She gets in the shower and he writes a note saying that he has to leave to meet a friend. The boy thinks of himself as a loser, and proclaims the next time he comes across a girl in her underwear, he'll just stick his Johnny into her. Boing! Punpun proceeds to walk around town like a zombie. Onodera! Over here! Says Sachi. They head back to her apartment, and when she bends down, Punpun stares down at her exposed underwear. I ought to stick my Johnny in her cheeky little cooch. Sachi wonders if Punpun was rushing off to his girlfriend on that day, as she turns around and looks at him. Over dinner, Punpun reveals that he lied about meeting up with his friend that day. He also reveals that when she was sleeping, he peeped at her crotch. And to be perfectly honest, I masturbated for the first time in 3 years last night. Sachi laughs it off, saying she's honored to have served as inspiration for his wank. She then pulls out her notebook, saying she wants him to write the story for the picture book. Punpun needs to settle things with Aiko first, before his 2 years are up. Sachi claims he's making excuses to pity himself, and that she could find this girl in 3 days. I said stop! Then just die already. Sachi writes her number down as Punpun leaves. I'll be looking forward to reading your story. Sweet Lonely Heart Fluffy Bro, i.e. Wada, shares his story on how he met Pegasus to Sachi. He asks her out, yet she refuses and instructs him to stop stalking her. Punpun hands his story to Sachi, but she says it's terrible. Kani's older sister then barges in. Sachi scolds Punpun for attempting to give up again and decides to get some coffee. Kani's older sister says that Sachi's dream was to become a manga artist. Although she came close to serialization, she didn't quite get there, hence why she transitioned to children's books. Afterwards, Sachi is a bit embarrassed that Punpun knows about her past, but is encouraged that he'll give the story another go. Sachi looks at the apartment with Punpun, since the stalker knows where she lives. Unfortunately, she hits her head in the bathroom, which reopens an old scar. Punpun accepts a computer job from the apartment manager, and he suggests that him and Sachi should date one another, but she brushes this off. The manager's daughter then excoriates Punpun for his lazy attitude, saying he doesn't contribute anything to society. Sachi defends Punpun as the manager eases the tensions. Later on, Sachi remarks that she wasn't defending him, but a younger version of herself. However, she's pushing forward with her life, unlike Punpun. Punpun claims her confidence comes from her brimming talent, yet she says she had plastic surgery on her face. She claims that Punpun's worries are empty, and he does nothing more than lick his own wounds. Punpun's tetrahedron form opens up, releasing the bird within. She looks to leave, but Punpun requests to make a manga. His new vigor comes from the fact that he doesn't want to become rude like her. Though the pressure of this new challenge weighs down on him, Punpun decides to trust Sachi. Punpun is making good progress with his manga. At the bar, Sachi wants to avoid an escapist manga to write something that can, quote-unquote, fight reality. Punpun takes her home and says he'll keep trying harder as Sachi falls asleep. The manager encourages Punpun to pick up Sachi after work to take her to the festival. Nevertheless, a man grabs her bags after work as they walk away. This is what I get for letting my guard down for even a second. Punpun is having a bad day. Punpun contemplates killing Sachi as she knocks on the door to check in on him. When she enters, Punpun lies about having a cold. Sachi then reveals it was her ex-husband that picked her up that day. She wants to see the fireworks with him, but Punpun says that if he continues being nice to him, he'll fall in love with her. Punpun, it's fine with me if you want to fall in love with me. Punpun reveals that Sachi reminds him of his dead mother. Punpun, you can take your clothes off too. Goodbye, Midori. Goodbye, Kani. Goodbye, Aiko. I'm alright now. The next day, Sachi, please call me a yellow-livered dickhead from now on. Sachi claims they don't have to become overly involved or change the dynamic of their friendship. It's winter time now, and Sachi and Punpun have a playful snowball fight. On Sachi's birthday, Punpun buys her a watch. She draws a sketch of him. However, Punpun, hey, over here. Don't you go and be all happy like you're some normal, well-adjusted person, you worthless trash. Punpun is steaming in rage. 1 year later, Punpun and Sachi continue working on their manga. Kinney's older sister sends out a wedding announcement for the new year. Seki is now working as a trash man as he meets Shimizu for lunch. Seki urges Shimizu to be more independent, which draws a sour face from the boy. Sachi and Punpun wait for their meeting with the editor as Pegasus announces his candidacy for the governor of Tokyo.
Good vibrations.
Aiko emerges behind Shimizu, dressed in all black. Seki wishes her luck for her modeling career, but she says he's mistaking her for someone else. Pegasus says the world came to an end long ago.
So throw aside all else and bear your hopes. Let us create a new world together. The potential exists within you. I must admit, I am God.
Hello everyone. Seki finds a magazine with Aiko in it. Sachi and Punpun enter the meeting with the editor. Though Sachi's artwork is good, the story is inaccessible to most of the readers. The self-pity of the main protagonist is annoying, and he seems spoiled. Sachi and the editor go back and forth, hitting an impasse. Outside, Punpun reassures her that everything will be alright, since she's a genius. Pegasus says on July 7th, the Earth will go kablam! He has gathered comrades to avoid the coming despair. He then rephrases his initial assertion, claiming that the end is not coming, but a rebalancing to its ideal state. If he becomes governor, he will free all of Tokyo.
My chest! It's swelling with excitement! We shall create a new world! Good vibrations.
Kinney's older sister criticizes Sachi for not caring about the recent earthquake. The two go back and forth, taking shots at one another. Things get testy as the apartment manager breaks things up. Sachi returns to Punpun's messy apartment. Noticing he hasn't made any progress on the manga, Punpun feels useless, and what's worse, he's dragging Sachi down. Punpun feels like Sachi's pet, so she says they'll go their separate ways from here on. Seki thinks about a time in his childhood when he was with Shimizu and his mother. In the now, Seki asks some co-workers who they save in a situation with a friend and his mother walking down the street with a truck heading straight for them. After they answer his question, he admits there's no right answer. At home, Seki pleasures his woman, but she gets angry when he talks about Shimizu all the time. In the past, Seki saved Shimizu from the truck as a naive boy desperately asked where his mommy was. From that day forward, Seki decided to always protect Shimizu. Seki tells him to be more independent, but Shimizu says he needs to tend to his mother.
Your mom's been dead for a long time! Did you forget?
Seki and Shimizu go to the Cosmo Health Center, tasked with the responsibility of disposing of old equipment. Pegasus arrives, spouting his usual mantra, but his brother scolds him and says his dad's not around to support him anymore. The brother says that when Pegasus was younger, he constructed a gigantic triangular pyramid out of 900 desks in a single night. With the help of some classmates. With just two more people, I can fight against the wicked dissonance. The dark spot is lurking in our midst. Pegasus then calls Shimizu a comrade. Shimizu and Seki argue with one another. While in the truck, Seki is told by Wada that he has a job for him that involves pushing a button. At the Cherry Blossom Festival, Mimura urges Punpun to reconcile his differences with Sachi. Mimura then says it would be nice if they could all meet up again like this. The apartment manager wants to buy Punpun a driver's ed book, since his real estate training is proceeding smoothly. Sachi disappears, and a female shopper accuses the apartment manager of shoplifting. She looks to steal his wallet, so he slaps her in the face. She cries assault, and a shopkeeper tackles him to the ground. Pegasus follows the woman instigator outside, calling her the Dark Spot. The manager suffers a dislocated shoulder and a spinal cord injury. The daughter talks of selling the place and turning it into a parking lot. Sachi says she'll never forgive the security guards and the old hag for doing this. However, the manager weakly tells her to be nice with everyone. Sachi wonders what she can do in this situation as she tells Punpun not to touch her. Punpun's contract ended last month, reminding him of his vow to kill himself if anything didn't change. I briefly tried to follow the light in the tunnel, but the tunnel gradually became darker and darker. Punpun then has a weird dream.
Are you the one that can?
No, I'm not. I'm never one of those who can. Pegasus says he's a victim of the dark spot.
Welcome back, Punpun.
The Pegasus ensemble, now including Shimizu, are ready to extinguish the darkness. They pose in a similar manner to the Last Supper. Punpun's life seems to be in a complete disarray. Frankly, he was tired of himself. Punpun tosses all his things into the trash. He then hears his neighbor, Takashi, have sex, and he masturbates to the thought of how perfect his life is. Punpun has a surge of homoerotic thoughts race through his mind. That night, Onodera Punpun died. Punpun then pretends to be Takashi, which seems to be going great, until... Aiko sits next to him. Onodera then wanted to holler at all the worthless sacks of crap out there in the world. This world is mine! You're Punpun, right?
Aiko!
She asks if he wants to go out for lunch next time. Aiko then tells Punpun that she's working as a model, which was her dream job. Later on, they sit down for lunch, with Punpun in disbelief that Aiko is talking right before his eyes. Punpun then lies about being a university student and having a girlfriend. He asks about Yuguchi, but she says that she broke up with him in middle school. She talks about her current boyfriend, but mentions how they're going through a rough patch. The conversation continues with Punpun's disappointment rising.
This girl isn't... the Aiko I know.
Sachi's new, cliched manga is accepted by the editor, as he claims that Punpun was holding her down. Punpun hangs out with the girl that he met at Driver's Ed. She talks about going to one of his soccer games in the future, but then, a change occurs. He leaves abruptly.
This is wrong. Is that what my face always looked like?
Aiko ruined Punpun's life. He meets her again for lunch, with his face resuming its normal form. Punpun seems to be at ease acting like Takashi, but he mentions that he feels like an actor delivering empty lines. Aiko wonders why they never ran into each other until now. The two talk about how they were both awkward kids, and how they could have gone insane with Aiko laughing.
The fuck are you laughing about? How is any of this funny at all?
The two hold hands briefly with Aiko saying they shouldn't be doing this. Punpun then blurts out, "Let's go to a hotel." The two embrace each other in the hotel room, with Punpun thinking she's just another slut.
I want to make your life miserable.
Punpun starts groping her, but Aiko demands that he stops. She says that she's done, and it must be nice enjoying a good life. Aiko says it would have been better if they never met as she leaves the room. Punpun walks through his life in a numb state, thinking that he'll move away to a town far, far away. Punpun then lets himself into Sachi's house. He reads her manuscript and puts her underwear over his head.
Who are you?
Says Sachi's ex-husband. The three go out together to get something to eat. Sachi's ex-husband philosophizes about happiness and one's place in the world. The man then condescends to Punpun, with Punpun saying that they'll never get along. That's all. Sachi updates Punpun that the magazine is going to publish her manga and that she's pregnant. And the baby is Satome's, her ex-husband's. Sachi, who's more important to you, your ex-husband or me? You, you're a lot more important, says Sachi. Sachi doesn't plan on telling Satome, and asks Punpun if he'll go to the hospital with her to get an abortion.
Yes, says Punpun.
After the surgery, Punpun decides that he'll move far away. Aiko asks to talk to Punpun after his driver's ed class. According to Pegasus, the Akashic records have foretold that a new world will be born on July 7th. The ensemble plays their song as Aiko recognizes it from elementary school. Punpun admits that he's a bum, and he's been lying about his exploits. He spent the last 10 years looking for her, since his broken promise to go to Kagoshima has left him a husk of a man. To see Aiko as a well-adjusted person, unlike him, makes him feel like a failure. You promised me that if you ever betrayed me again, then I could kill you. Nevertheless, she forgives him. Thanks for waiting for me all this time. I've been waiting for you too all this time. Pegasus's glasses shatter as he lies on the ground. Aiko admits to all her lies, saying it was just a means to get Punpun to like her. Aiko decides to leave for the night, but not until she gives Punpun a kiss on the lips. The spell Aiko cast on him wasn't something that he could free himself from easily. Aiko goes to her factory job that her mother forced her into. One of her co-workers makes vulgar comments. Another one defends her, but she just wants to be left alone. At home, her mother buys a bronze statue and asks Aiko if she could get an advance in her pay. Aiko is tired of supporting her mother and wants to live a better life. Pegasus has been sleep-talking for 5 days straight. The world will still come to an end, but he believes it will become more beautiful. Aiko cries in her bed, with bloody tissues scattered everywhere. Sachi gives Punpun the option of not going with her to the abortion, as Aiko knocks on the door.
Punpun opens up as Aiko hears the tail end of the conversation. She walks away, but he grabs her hand. Just tell me what you're really thinking.
You too, replies God.
Punpun rips her shirt off, revealing her breast. Punpun brings her inside and starts touching her body ever so delicately. He then enters Aiko, blowing away any notion of restraint. Aiko asks him to come inside, but he pulls out at the last moment. The two then admit they like each other. If there was a place lower than here, it would surely be hell. Midori is now pregnant. Punpun and Aiko discuss moving away together. Punpun wants Aiko to give a proper explanation to her mother before leaving. Let's go right now, alright? Punpun claims that his world is now Aiko's, and Aiko's alone. The cab they're in then drives past Sachi, who is waiting for Punpun to go to the abortion clinic. There's no turning back now. Shimizu has a dream where buildings in Tokyo explode. Pegasus claims that if the dark spot remains, this vision will come to pass. Aiko is scared of persuading her mother, yet the prospect of living with Punpun makes her happy beyond belief. I love her so much, I could just bite her tongue off and kill her.
What are those?
Oh, well, it's cranberry juice, cran apple,
says Punpun. They reach the door and walk in. Aiko tells her mom she's leaving the house and living with Punpun for now on. She'll send money every month, as they decide to talk it over with some tea. In the midst of the discussion, the mother punches Aiko in the head, calling her a failure. Tensions escalate, with Aiko saying she doesn't need any family anymore. The mother pulls out a butcher knife, swinging it in Aiko's direction. She nearly hits Punpun. After missing Aiko with the knife, she stomps down on her side. Aiko weakly apologizes to her mother, as God says, I know I've been waiting a long time for this moment. Hello, Punpun. Punpun tackles the mother. The mother reaches for a pair of scissors and jabs it into Punpun's leg. Nevertheless, he strangles her with all his anger and rage in front of Aiko's unflinching eyes. Aiko, it's all fine now. A man with a package knocks on the door. Punpun answers the door, saying that Mrs. Tanaka is out for now. Aiko stabs her dead mother's body as Punpun finds out there's a vibrator in the package. Aiko laughs and cries in a delirious state. Afterwards, Punpun sews up Aiko's wound. Yuichi contemplates his life's decisions as he talks about the baby's name with Midori. The lady who framed the apartment manager tells her daughter to run as Pegasus looks to eliminate her with a hammer, since she's the dark spot. The lady begs for him to leave them alone, so he sprints away. Wada informs him that the elimination of the dark spot is crucial to their purpose. Wada says Pegasus is the closest thing to God and he must go into space. Aiko wakes up from a bad dream as she stares down at the nightmare of her mother wrapped up in duct tape. The two drive into the woods with Punpun digging the hole for the body. On the car ride back, Punpun says, I don't think what I've done was the least bit wrong. Punpun claims that her death will go unnoticed, and that it's better this way, since she was an inconvenience to society. Punpun tells Aiko to pin everything on him, as he'll do his best to preserve his freedom. Please don't leave me alone. Punpun reveals that he believed everyone to be far nicer and smarter than him, hence the reason he was timid and depressed. But now he's realized that humans are deplorable, and that there's no such thing as a decent human being. Punpun feels refreshed by what he did, and that the world could stand for a little more chaos. Aiko has another nightmare of peeing herself in class. She experiences a panic attack, so Punpun attempts to cover her mouth with his hand. She bites down, so he throws her to the ground. However, she loses a tooth in the process. Why did things turn out like this? Punpun then asks Aiko if she wants to go to Kagoshima. Pegasus develops three theories about the dark spot. 1. It moves from person to person. 2. He imagined it. And 3. It's in everyone. Seki breaks up with his girlfriend, so she tells his boss and his dad that he hit her. Seki is shocked by the news, deciding to quit shortly afterwards. Later on, some men come knocking on his door, demanding that he apologizes to the boss, since it was his daughter that he quote-unquote hit. Seki then asks to stay with Shimizu for a while, and to have faith in him. I want to believe you, but you never believe me. Shimizu's mother then waves him goodbye. Mommy, you're still right there as always, right? The hand then disappears as Shimizu is off for the day. Seki is ready to accept the button-pushing job as long as it doesn't hurt anyone. Wada eases his concerns. He mentions how Pegasus's predictions always come true, and according to him, the universe is a musical box that is singing an unstable tune. On July 7th, the quote-unquote promised despair will befall the world.
They will play the same song every day to restore the harmony. Despite this, however, the calamity will occur. Pegasus will thusly be remembered, and the farce of the world will be revealed for what it is. Wada then says there was a man 10 years ago who killed his family, who he intended to make the new god. Unfortunately, he ended up turning himself into the police. Wada tells Seki to spend time with his loved ones, and that he'll make Hoshikawa Toshiki a god of the people. Pegasus stands up with the entire ensemble saying they love him. Pegasus reminds them that there is nothing they can't do or achieve. Aiko asks Punpun if he'll kill her someday, but he tells her to get some sleep. They look up at the night sky, and Aiko asks him if there was a shooting star, what he'd wish for. I'd wish for shooting stars to disappear forever. Punpun then looks into the mirror to see God's face on his own.
Sup.
Sup. Punpun thinks about letting loose on his emotions. Aiko redoes her bandages, as Punpun seems uncaring about her difficulties. Aiko says he only needs to focus on her, so it'd be more convenient with only one eye. Sachi begins to worry about Punpun, as Punpun scolds Aiko for not gouging his eye out properly.
But I love you, Punpun.
Punpun angrily tells Aiko she needs to be more serious. Sachi enlists the help of Mimura, but Punpun is nowhere to be found. Mimura, however, remains resolute that Punpun will return. Aiko gives Punpun oral sex in the bathroom. Later on, Punpun has a dream about various people in his life, including the star he discovered when he was a boy. Punpun instructs Aiko to choke him tighter, but she can't bear the thought of being without him. Aiko sees a report of a robbery case in her hometown, which causes her to panic. Sachi, Kani, and her older sister talk about Punpun being too nice in his daily affairs. The apartment manager's daughter says her dad won't be able to use his legs anymore, and that Punpun brought Manekineko dolls to him 2 to 3 times a week. She then gives Sachi a key to Punpun's apartment. When she walks in, she finds blood on his sheets. She looks at Punpun's cell phone, only to find Midori in the contacts. Sachi then contacts Midori, revealing that she's worried about his well-being. Yuichi takes Sachi to Punpun's previous house, which has henceforth been demolished. Yuichi claims he understands the boy, and likens Sachi to his mother. Sachi then remembers all her memories with Punpun, and henceforth lays next to the picture she drew of him long ago. Sachi is then given a chance to turn in a 2-volume manga, which she believes will make her normal. Punpun and Aiko sleep in the car, as the rain prevents them from seeing the Milky Way. June 27th, Punpun scarfs down a handful of pills. Aiko writes down her wish on a Tanabata tree, but Punpun calls her stupid and drags her away.
Don't worry, it's just a normal lover's spat. So quit staring at us, you dipshits.
Punpun looks up suicide methods on the computer, as he seems in disbelief that he really killed someone. Sachi visits Papa Punpun, who's working as a nurse. Sachi wishes to know about Punpun's childhood. Papa says that he was talkative, smart, and more mature than other kids. Aiko's wound isn't healing properly, as she scarfs down a bunch of pills. A man in a convenience store says that a manga written by Sachi is boring. He then leaves his can on the sidewalk, and Punpun proceeds to shadow him until he turns around. Punpun henceforth berates the man for his laziness, so the man finally decides to take his can to the trash. Punpun continues denigrating him, so he pushes back.
You're a real mouthy punk, aren't ya? Guys like you piss me off the most.
Papa talks about the time Punpun chased the shooting star in the second grade. His friend, Watanabe, did the same, but was hit by a motorcycle at an intersection. Punpun henceforth blamed himself for the incidents, and thusly became a reserved, meek boy. Meanwhile, Punpun furiously beats the man down, as Aiko begs for him to stop. They enter the car, but the man throws a flagpole at them, so they're forced to speed off. Sachi leaves Papa Punpun and tells Kani's older sister that she has to protect Punpun. Aiko says that Punpun has gotten a little strange, but he claims it's everyone else who's gotten strange. They finally arrive in Kagoshima. While Aiko sleeps, Punpun wanders off without his wallet and backpack. Afterwards, they board a ferry to visit a space museum. Aiko talks about what ifs, but Punpun scolds her for doing so. The two then immerse themselves in the beautiful landscapes. Aiko talks about a potential baby, but Punpun scolds her for bringing up pointless what-ifs. Punpun then reverts to his innocent bird form, saying he's really happy right now. They gleefully play in the sand and water. Punpun, am I going to be killed here?
Yes.
Punpun ties a rope around her neck, and she asks him for sex.
Don't worry, I'll soon join you in death.
Aiko says she doesn't want to die, and urges Punpun to live on. Aiko claims that Punpun didn't kill her mother, as she was still living, hence the reason why she stabbed her with a knife. Punpun screams over and over that she's lying,
But Aiko claims it's the truth. Afterwards, Aiko says she'll stay on the island as she asks what he'll do.
Dear God, Tinko Hoi. I wonder when it was that I realized talking with God was merely talking to my own self.
Aiko, let's get married. Pegasus insinuates that he's aware of Wada's true plans. Two men who work for Seki's old boss come to rough him up. They then threaten him with fire as he drifts off into old memories. He thinks of Sachi in the factory and how she was there years later when it was abandoned. The factory going bankrupt ruined his life. Seki tells Shimizu not to hang out with the Pegasus ensemble and to move to a faraway place like Tibet with him. Shimizu refuses, so Seki returns to Wada's house. Wada's mother asks for Seki to turn on the TV for her, and he wonders if this is the esteemed button-pushing job that Wada was alluding to. Pegasus gives his last message to the public, saying that the age of the individual is coming to an end with the start of the age of the collective. On July 7th, he hopes to engrave harmony into the Akashic records. Good vibrations, a beautiful world for you. The Pegasus ensemble then expresses their fears of killing themselves. Wada is disappointed in their convictions, so he pours gasoline and lights a match. Seki listens to Wada's tape. Wada wonders what Seki believes in and states that they both have troublesome friends. Seki then catches a glimpse of a giant explosion, making him worry about Shimizu. Aiko finds work as Punpun fills out a phone contract in her name. As she walks in to tell Punpun about the good news, a news report says that Mrs. Tanaka's corpse was found and they are actively searching for Aiko to shed light on the matter. Let's just calm down and think about it. The two decide they can no longer stay on the island. Seki climbs into the burning building, hoping to find his friend Shimizu. He passes various members of the Pegasus ensemble, both dead and alive. He then finds Shimizu unconscious and throws him over his back. He then comes across Pegasus, completely ablaze. Even if this body of mine rots away, forgotten by all, I believe the vibrations of my magical warriors will reverberate to you all. Good vibrations. Seki carries Shimizu's body to safety, but when he looks up, he sees the God of Poop spaceship with the Pegasus ensemble inside, including Shimizu. Aiko's condition is worsening, as Punpun suggests that she goes to the hospital.
I see how it is. You actually want me to be caught!
They catch a taxi, with Aiko aiming to reach her uncle, who is a doctor. The taxi driver stops at a convenience store and takes an especially long time inside. Aiko gets worried that her identity may have been compromised, so they leave the cab and travel on foot. The two deviate from the roads and travel through the forest. Aiko, however, gets suspicious, accusing Punpun that he led her out here to kill her and bury her body. Aiko defends herself with a knife, but Punpun placidly says that he's here to protect her no matter what. She then shoves the knife into his chest.
You really are such a dumb shit.
He tells her not to think as they proceed to have sex until daybreaks. Aiko indicates they're near her uncle's house as Punpun tacitly threatens to hurt him if he takes unfavorable actions against them. Unfortunately, the clinic is shut down and the town is mostly abandoned. Aiko says they'll search for a police station after a short rest. Punpun claims he'll take the blame for the murder. Aiko admits that when they saw the shooting star as kids, she wished that he would fall in love with her. July 1st, 2 p.m. Punpun wakes up alone, finding Aiko's hat on the ground. He then walks over to Aiko, who's hanging from a rope. He takes her down and throws her over his back. Let's go, Aiko. Punpun talks about a potential life with Aiko and his dream of being killed by her. Punpun continues his trek through the sweltering heat. He cleans up Aiko and calls the 911 emergency service. After being questioned about his emergency, he hangs up the phone. Punpun strokes her hair and some kids walk in. Punpun asks the kids to watch Aiko as he goes to the phone booth to retrieve his bag. He trips on his trek and twists his leg. After returning, the kids and Aiko are gone. Punpun reads Aiko's Tanabata wish, "May you never forget me." Pegasus and his followers reach Punpunia, the star Punpun saw as a child. It is our victory. God-shaped meteorites then descend towards the Earth. It is now July 7th, and Punpun is just fine again today. Punpun returns to the abandoned factory that he visited with his friends when he was a child. The figure he saw when he was a child was himself as an adult.
I've become strong.
You sure this was the only way?
Shall we hurry back to that dull and tiresome everyday life? Die then. No, you die.
Punpun then rips out the eye where God resides. Midori tells Yuichi that the baby is coming. Sachi is throwing away all of her old possessions, including her painting of the Milky Way. Saji talks about her childhood and how she would show Seki her manga when she finally finished it. Saji is turning a new leaf in her life. Through her hard work and dedication, she admits she never saw the Milky Way. Hence, her painting was a lie. She's stepping forward with her life nonetheless, wondering what kind of future she pictured for herself. Shimizu then asks Seki who he is. "I'm your friend," says Seki. Mimura has no luck in finding Punpun. He tells his girlfriend that he loves her as the meteorites descend upon the Earth. Wada watches Pegasus's YouTube video, which only has 1600 views and a dismal like-to-dislike ratio. With both Aiko and God gone, Punpun plans on entering a permanent sleep. "Punpun, wake up," says Saji. Saji grabs Punpun's arm and lifts him up. "You're mine and mine alone." Punpun has surgery on his eye as Saji shows him the concept art for her next story. She'll wait as long as it takes for him to share what happened as she's off for the day. Police stop her, telling her that Punpun is a murder suspect and they need to ask him a few questions. They then enter Punpun's room to interrogate him about the incident. Yuichi's baby, Sohara, is born. In the baby's left eye, we see a tiny version of God. Punpun chronicles the events to Aiko. His probation is over and he started work as a real estate agent. Mimura is getting married next year and Sachi's daughter is growing close to Punpun. He equates his existence to that of a ghost, but he seems satisfied. Punpun wonders if they really saw the Milky Way as children, or if it was just a glorified image by their imaginations. Aiko's voice and appearance is fading away in Punpun's memories. "Aiko, I'm sorry for being a liar. I have to keep on moving forwards. I'm sorry, Aiko. Goodbye." It's the end of Harumin's first semester as a teacher, as the class says goodbye to a female student. He then attends an elementary class reunion, thanking Seki for inviting him. Seki says that Shimizu is busy working as a nurse, so he couldn't make it. Later on, Harumin's fiance gets fitted for a wedding dress. Harumin takes a walk outside, wondering if this is what they call normal. Harumin then runs into Punpun as they start up a conversation. "When you transferred schools, I was really lonely," says Punpun. Saji then intervenes with her daughter. Harumin inquires if he's married to Saji, yet he doesn't question further about the subject or his eye when he gets no response. He then waves goodbye to the group, knowing that this will be the last time he sees Punpun. That being said, Harumin never recalls Punpun's name. Harumin resumes his teaching duties as a new girl is introduced to the class. A little boy stares on with a look of love in his eyes. "Hey, did you know? Humanity's going extinct."